Welcome to You Know Me, a podcast for Brunswick and the Golden Isles. I'm Buda.
I'm the Beard.
And it's September now. Can't believe it.
Yeah, football season.
That's right. It's football and pumpkin spice.
So, do those two things go together? Can you have like a pumpkin spice football?
I hope not. Football and pumpkin spice should not go together.
You might upset some viewers.
I know. Well, you know, it's the time of year. NFL just started, so we're going to have a lot of NFL widows. And, but high school football has started. Yes. And we're here with Coach. Coach, why don't you introduce yourself to everyone and tell us a little bit about yourself.
My name is Rocky Hidalgo. I'm the head football coach here at Glynn Academy, finishing up my 11th year here, or just starting my 11th year, I suppose. Married to an awesome wife, got three awesome kids. My daughter is a college volleyball player at Young Harris. Son is a senior here at Glynn Academy, plays tight end on the football team, is kind of a genius guy. I don't know where he got that. I accused my wife of having an affair because my kids are so smart. And then I have a 12-year-old who's in seventh grade. You know, I'm just kind of a normal dude. Like some college football, get on my boat, drink a beer, and do a little fishing every now and then.
Yeah,
that sounds great.
I hear that. So, did you play high school? Did you play football in high school?
I did. Played football in high school and in college. I played at Rhodes College in Memphis, Tennessee, a little D3 school. I had never been anywhere when I went off to college. I was I was 18 years old. Grew up in a small town in Louisiana, and had never been on an airplane. I'd been to Biloxi, Mississippi, and Houston, Texas. Those are the two places I'd ever been. And college was good for me because it allowed me to kind of go see parts of the world I'd only read about or seen on television.
Were you always fascinated with football? How did you get into football?
I always grew up, I always wanted to coach. My dad coached like little league and youth football, so we were always around it. Even when I was in high school, I used to go to his games and sit up in the box. He bought a pair of headsets, and I would sit in the box and be on the headsets during the rec football games. And I've always kind of been fascinated with the game. It's been awesome for me. The game has been awesome for me. I think a lot of people, I tell people this, is football is a vehicle for, or not just football, but sports are a vehicle for kids. And it allows them, it takes them places that they never get a chance to go without it. Right. And it opens doors sometimes that would never open without it. Yeah. And that's what it was with me. It allowed me to meet a bunch of amazing people that were kind of outside my sphere of influence, but also go to places and go, go to California and Pittsburgh and just all over the country to play some college football games and meet people from all over the country. Just broaden my horizons a bunch.
Yeah, yeah.
And also you get a lot of life lessons out of playing too, and kind of really figure out who you are as a person.
Yeah, you know, I think I believe football is the greatest sport on the planet. I do, and of course I'm biased, but it's a difficult sport. A lot of people think guys who play football are dummies, and that's not really the case. The people who play football are generally some of the smartest people in the school. It's because it's 11th to the 11th power. Football is kind of always in motion, and there's a lot of learning and understanding that you have to do to be good at it. But the other side is 90% of football, and I talk to the kids all the time about this, is 90% of football is it sucks. I mean, it sucks. It's mm-hmm. different than any other sport where baseball, once baseball season goes, you're playing three or four games a week. Basketball, you're doing that. The majority of those games, even when you're practicing, is playing the sport. Football is very, very different. 90% of what you do is not playing the sport. It's broken down into these core components where it's you working against another offensive lineman with a coach yelling at you, and you've got 40 pounds of equipment on. It's hot. It's the idea of this delayed gratification. It's an investment in yourself. It's learning to kind of struggle through some things and developing grit. I tell people grit is a skill, and grit is a skill that is sorely lacking in our society nowadays, especially among young people. We have an inability to overcome adversity. I mean, right. Adversity, a lot of people just wilt when they struggle with things. And I talk about this, struggle makes us strong. Football teaches adversity. It teaches grit. Grit's a skill. And if you don't practice being gritty, if you don't practice those things, then you have no chance to be mentally tough. And so that's why I think it's the greatest sport, I think. And it's not that's not detracting or taking away from any other sports.
Right.
I just think football is unique in that. And that's why I love it. That's how I love working with the kids in the community, because I see our kids grow. Everybody thinks of your favorite players are the guy, Coach DJ Dallas, who's playing in the NFL, and Chase Thomas, who played in the NFL, and those were great players. But my favorite players are always the ones that had to really work really hard to be good at it. The program kids that showed up every day 200 times a year and busted their hump in the weight room to make themselves into somebody on the football field. And that type of attitude, that type of dedication, that approach to life, mm-hmm. those are the kids that are going to be, regardless what's in front of them, are always going to have the ability to overcome things because they've learned it in our football program.
Right, right.
So you talked about it a little bit, they only play one game a week, whereas baseball, they'll play 3 or 4 games a week, basketball, 3 or 4 games a week. You practice all week for one game. What goes into those practices? How do you get your guys ready for playing? I know you're running plays, but there's still a lot of skill sets you have to install. There's still a lot of drills that go on. It's time to make you, to make your position better, but others can build that grit.
Yeah.
I remember doing like the Oklahoma drills and a few other drills that every football player hates to do.
Yeah.
But that's what it does. It builds up that toughness.
Football, if you're a football coach, good football coaches are great teachers. And you have to have I was talking with somebody today about this. Is really good football coaches are able to identify a problem and formulate a solution for it very, very well. And that's one of those things when you go and you watch guys coach, you see guys, and they may come up with different scenarios to solve that problem, but they're in this problem, the solution business, and they come up with those solutions sometimes in their own unique way. I think when you go to a football practices are very organized. There's a thought process, to me, a lot of teachers in the school building could learn a lot from coaches about how to approach and teach things. I was asked to help with the county literacy teachers about some of their instruction. Basically, what they want to do is teach some of these new teachers how to be better teachers. And they want Coach Grady, who's the head football coach at Brunswick High, and I, to sit down and kind of show them a little bit about coaching, because they're thinking of this in terms of a team mentality and coaching other people. And we kind of broke it out, and we explained to them that what we want to do is show you what goes into coaching our kids. How much time, effort, and energy is put into getting someone to do something very, very, very small.
Right.
Something as easy as just steps. And that's everything is about how we do our steps and all that stuff, our footwork, our stance, because football is built on a million little bitty details.
Yeah.
And that's what coaching's about. Practice planning, organization, all of those things.
So a lot of analyticals, logistics.
That's part of it. Part of it is breaking down your opponent and understanding what you're going to have to do to kind of be to win. How do you hide your weaknesses and overcome their strengths, that's part of it, but that's a very small part of it. And for me, I don't really care or worry about our opponent. I focus on us. I don't spend any time worrying about losing games. I focus on winning.
Right.
Everything we do is focused on winning games. So that's the first thing. But it's more than just analyzing an opponent and saying, hey, these are the plays we need to stop. It starts with us. Everything is about us. If we go and play well and perform well and we are fundamentally sound, great things are going to happen.
Right.
And that's kind of what we approach and we look at. And so football practice is about preparing for your opponent, but it's really more about preparing your players to kind of overcome whatever they're going to see on Friday night. That's my philosophy. It's always about us. It's never about the team we play.
Right.
How do you get yourself prepared? How do you get your coaching staff prepared for the week ahead of, before the game?
Well, it's like anything else. So it's football staff is an organization. There's a hierarchy. And so, one of the things when you go in, you have position coaches who are kind of, their perspective is very close. They're right in a player's face in his grill, working one-on-one. Then you have coordinators who are developing these kind of larger game plans, and slotting those players, those individual players in that game plan. Then you have a head coach who's looking at something, kind of this all program encompassing, mm-hmm. which is kind of how I see it. So the offensive coordinator is trying to figure out how to score points, and the defensive coordinator is trying to figure out how to stop the other team. The special teams coordinator is trying to figure out Friday night's special teams game plan. My job is to look at those things and say, hey guys, this team is really, really good on offense. So they're probably going to score 24, 27 points. So we've got to figure out a way to score 31 and 34 points, which is a different approach if you're an offensive coordinator than if I walk in here and say, hey, this is a really, really good defensive team. We're going to have to play great defense Friday night, and we're trying to find two ways to get in the end zone to win this game 14-10. So it's a program approach, a philosophy that we have to understand. Everybody, the defensive staff needs to understand what the offensive staff is facing. To understand that, if they're facing a great defensive football team, we're not going to score a lot of points this week. Then defensively, we may have to take more risks. Sometimes you have to risk getting beat 42-0 to have a chance to win the game if you're playing somebody who's better than you. I know a lot of people won't understand that, but there are a lot of games we could go in and lose 17-7. My goal isn't to lose close. My goal is to try to win games.
Right.
And so we have to risk against teams that are superior to us. And sometimes you beat them, not always, but sometimes you beat them. We have to risk getting beat badly because you have to take more risk in a game to beat a team who's better than you. And so with everybody's understanding, hey, we have to steal some possessions. That means we may have to fake some punts, an onside kick. So that goes, the special teams coordinator has to understand that. So when he's planning the game plan, he can have a perspective that's appropriate for this week. We're going to have to be aggressive. So that it all goes. So that's kind of my idea. That's what I do here. And I manage those coaches. And my job is to coach the coaches. When I see things, when I go back and watch film, hey, these things aren't getting done. You get what you inspect, not what you expect.
Right.
So my job is to inspect that the coaches are doing a great job. And if they're not, I look at them and go, hey, man, this has got to get coached better. Because every day is a job. I tell these guys, every day is a job interview. When you walk in here, you apply for a job and you say, I want to coach the defensive line at Glynn Academy, you're saying you're capable of coaching that job. So when they walk in the door here, they go down on the field, they can't do it, then two things are going to happen. One, they've got to improve in a hurry, or two, I'm going to start coaching them. If I have to coach that position, I don't need them anymore.
Right.
And that's no different than running a business. Uh-huh. And so guys have got to improve, and we have a standard here. We're not going to lower our standard because you can't keep up. That's for me, and that probably sounds really harsh to people, but that's kind of how we're going to run it.
Wow. That's how you run it. I mean, that's the way to do it. How do you get yourself prepared during the off season? The players, they're going to be hitting the gym. They're going to be doing road work. They're getting themselves ready. How do you get yourself ready for the next season coming up?
Well, I think that's, it's like anything else. It is a mindset, because football is it's a marathon. It's not a sprint.
Right.
People always go, well, you started football on August 1st. Football starts when our season ends. We have about 2 weeks where we kind of just low-key chill out, and then football starts again. And so football is a year-long process. It's 200 days a year. Now, once the football season gets here, it's 6 or 7 days a week. Even if you're at home, you're working, you're breaking down film. Everybody has a job to do. You know, our coaches work on Sundays. We come in, we meet at 1 o'clock on Sunday. By Sunday at 1 o'clock, they have to have all of their work done so that we can come and have, and that means they've got to input data into a computer from Friday night's film. And so they have to have all of that work done. So so mentally you have to prepare yourself. It's like steeling yourself for a long competition because it is, you know, from the last week in July until the state championship game, you know, is 21, 22 weeks. And it's 6 to 7 days a week for 22 weeks. It's not easy and it's hard. It's hard emotionally. It's hard mentally. So, you know, that's one thing. You have to prepare yourself mentally that you're about to go into this and you just got to take a deep breath and go get after it. It's kind of like you got to attack it. The other side is what we have to do is we have to prepare ourselves in the off season. Once, you know, in January, February, March, we have to do things like, you know, what are we going to do from a program-wide standpoint in terms of offensive, defensive play, special teams? You know, we always look at our kids, and I tell people this, our coaches, don't tell me what our kids can't do. Tell me what they can do, and let's build a football team around them. I'm not tied to a particular offense or defense. What I want to do is put the best 11 players on the field and do what those kids can do. So sometimes we may have a kid that's a great running quarterback. We might be a triple option team. We have a kid that can throw the ball. We may be a more pro style team. So that's a point in January. We have to have taken evaluation of our kids and go, these are things that they can do. The other side of that is the strength conditioning aspect of it is going in before Christmas and saying, okay, these are the things we want to accomplish in the weight room. And how are we going to get there? Likewise, we have to look at your depth chart and go, these are the positions where we don't have a lot of people. We have to develop some kids here. So these three players have got to have a great offseason for us to have success. So beginning in when we come back from Christmas break, that's a big focus. Those individuals that we feel like are keys to our success, you know, we're gonna stay on those guys. Because if they can't get it done, we got to find somebody else. We got to come up with a different plan. So those are all the things that we do, you know, or some of the things that we do to prepare ourselves for the season. But it's a big chore. It's a long season.
Wow. How has coaching for you changed since you started? Has it changed a lot for you in terms of how you coach or the type of players you're getting or
even technology?
Technology has been huge. I mean, first off, technology, you know, you film practice with drones, excuse me, have high def cameras, you know, 4K cameras. So you can see, you can see the hand placement on a guy, how his foot movement, you can slow-mo these things and frame for frame, you know, pick these things up and see, you can zoom in on a video where before it was just grainy and you really couldn't see what's going on. Now you can take video, 4K video from a drone, and I can see where a kid's putting his first step and look on the film and go, this guy's step's not in the right spot. So technology's been huge. Also things like huddle, sharing video. You know, used to have to take actually video film and get a copy made and then drive that. Everybody would drive this one place and get your films copied. And he would make films, give it to you, and then he would drive it over to your opponent. You know, and then there were VHS tapes, and then there were DVDs. And now it's all in the cloud. And so, you know, you share video with just a click of a button. If you wanted to get video on somebody back in the day, you had to drive all the way across the state to get it. Now you just pick the phone up, and within 10 seconds, you have it. So technology has been huge. And that doesn't even get into things like the safety aspect of it because how much the equipment's changed. You know, kids have changed a bunch, but kids have always been changing. And I think you kind of have to adapt. You have to be fluid when you deal with young people. I don't necessarily think kids are any worse or better than they used to be. I think they're just very different. I think their skills are very different. I think their strengths are very different. I think their weaknesses are very different, you know, and I don't think kids, young people don't have the capacity to handle adversity like they used to do. you know, and that's part of it. I do think they because of social media, they have probably a little more wherewithal about the world around them a little bit than I had in 1987 growing up in Denham Springs, Louisiana. I didn't know what people's lives were like in Boston. You know? I remember we hosted a Babe Ruth tournament, baseball tournament in South Louisiana. We had these guys come down, a baseball team come down from Boston, and they thought everything was going to be like Venice. They were going to take a boat everywhere. They thought there wasn't roads and they were going to take boats. But I mean, it's, you know, I remember going places and go, oh, that is nothing like when the first time I went to LA. It was blown away. It was nothing like I thought it was going to be. Kids today have a little more, you know, global awareness of what life is like in other countries. They're very different. They learn differently. But, you know, I'm a big believer in, you know, Confucius says, I hear and I forget, I see and I remember, I do and I understand.
Yep.
So kids today are no different than other kids, you know, from 40 years ago. You tell them to do something, they're going to suck at it because 99% of the people on the planet don't take, you know, oral instruction very well.
Yeah.
But the other side of this is they probably do better with video than kids 25 years ago. You show them film, they're better at that than kids 25 years ago. Mm-hmm. You know, my preferred means of teaching things is to show them and then let them do it and correct them as they do it. But correcting them, videotape it, and show them themselves, they're really good at learning that way.
Yeah.
Which, I probably would have not been able to do because I was not as versed, you know, I didn't watch as much TV back then.
Yeah. So like even you as a coach, you have to learn instructional techniques because you mentioned Confucius. That's I'm an instructor, and that is one of the things when I teach someone to be a new instructor, that's exactly the same quote that I use.
Yep.
So you have
you always have to learn, and each kid's different. You know, you have a football team. I have a football team, 130 kids, and my job is to get them to perform. And I tell people, you know, I was watching some young kids play football, and one of the coaches told me they can't get anybody to do this, and I was like, well, man, that's not a failure of the kid, it's a failure of the coaches. My job is to get them to perform. If I can't get them to perform, well, they, you know, if I can't get them to do the right things, that's on me. Now, every kid, every athlete can learn to do things correctly. Now, not all of them have the ability to be successful with it, but I can watch a film and go, that guy has been coached really well. He's just not very athletic. And then you watch a film on another kid who is really athletic and looks like a great player, but he's not coached particularly well. So those are the things, like when I think of those things, when I hear people talk about that, you know, every kid's going to be a little different how they learn. Some kids you can crawl up their backside and they're going to respond to that. Other kids, you got to coax them to do it. Some of them, and I say this, some of them have got to be drugged, some of them got to be carried, some of them got to be kicked. And some of them got to be pushed, but however we get those kids there, we got to get them there. And so that's all of our, that's, you know, some of them got to put your arm around and just escort them all the way to success. My job is to get them there regardless how we have to get them there.
Yeah. Now, do you see a difference between the different grade levels of, you know, you're speaking about the coaching, do you see a difference in the grade levels of how they respond?
Yeah, I mean, it is about, there's part of that. Like, part of working with young kids, you know, eighth graders, ninth graders, sophomores, is teaching them kind of the program culture, what football is going to be like. It's more about how to do things than what to do. As they get older, they learn more what to do. So how to do things, you know, can't and won't are the same thing in life.
Right.
You can have somebody who, and this kind of goes back to what I just said, you can have the most talented person on the planet. If they're not willing to do what they're supposed to do, it doesn't matter. They're going to be ineffective at it. Likewise, you can have a kid who does everything right and is not talented enough to get the job done. You're at the same point with both of them.
Right.
I would rather coach a kid who's not talented enough and is going to respond to coaching than a kid who's super talented and doesn't want to respond. And so young kids, for us, it's all about teaching them about the program. It's, you know, it's like It's like birthing a 12-pound baby sometimes. It's an ugly process. It's painful. And I tell people, I'm not always going to be nice to these guys. I'm hard on our players. I've got two sons and a daughter. I've been hard on all three of them. I love them. Every one of these kids in the program, I love. I love them like they're mine. But, I mean, I'm going to be hard on them. And I do that because I do care about them.
Right.
Mr. Rogers, I watched an interview with Mr. Rogers one time. And he talked about discipline is love. When we fail to discipline kids, we fail to love them. My job is to discipline these kids and get them to understand what they can and cannot do, what is acceptable, what's not acceptable. And when they learn that, then they are something that we can teach and we can mold and we can make into something. If they refuse to do the right things, you know, I need players, not problems.
Right.
I tell them up front, this is a program for players, not problems. I will be patient with them. I will bring them along and try to teach them. But at some point in time, when they remain to be players, they have to either do what they're asked to do or they have to graduate and move on from the program, go somewhere else and do something else. You know.
Now, how difficult is it to select the players to be on the football team? Like, how much heartache goes into it? How much thought?
Well, we don't have any cuts. I'm a big believer that every kid – that football is good for every kid, and some kids are good for football.
Right.
So if we have 180 come out, I'll go raise the money and put uniforms and pads on 180 kids.
Wow.
We have over 130 kids in the program right now. They're good kids. Most of them are doing what they're asked to do, and they go show up every day, and they work their tails off. So I don't cut any kids. I don't care if they're not any. We have some kids that aren't very good football players. We have some kids that are spectacular players. And everything in between. My goal every day is for those kids, every one of those 130 kids, to show up every day and make themselves better. Well, I got to tell them, we want to be good Americans. I want to be a better American. I want to be a better person, be a you know, son or daughter, brother or sister, teacher or student in the classroom, all of those things. We want to be better at that every day, including, you know, academically and athletically.
Right.
And so that's our goal with all those kids. Show up every day, bust your hump, then you get to stay part of the program, and I'll buy you a nice jacket when you graduate.
That's amazing. I love that.
That's awesome. So you're at a pretty high level. I mean, Glynn Academy is in one of the top divisions of the state.
Yes, sir.
You get a lot of talent comes through. You've got some players that have gone on to the NFL.
Mm-hmm.
You get into Division I schools with scholarships. How does that get into the mindset of some of these older players you have as they're getting into that about if when they are good enough to possibly have scouts looking at them, especially now with NIL?
Yep.
That's been a big thing, and I'm going to go on record. I've never been a fan of that. And then, you know, now there's the transfer portal. NCAA is kind of looking like a small version of the NFL
right
at this point. How is that a distraction for some of your players?
Well, I wouldn't say it's a distraction. Like I said earlier, I think football is a vehicle for these kids, and a lot of them want to play ball in college. My job is to try to make that as possible if I can. Now, I don't control scholarships, so the colleges are going to be the guys that determine if they're going to offer a kid or not offer a kid. So I don't, you know, but my job is to facilitate that best I can. Market our players to colleges, try to get them on college campus, take them to games, introduce them to college coaches, all those things. I think the recruiting has changed a ton in the past few years, specifically the early signing day. You know, it used to be kids could go and they could play their senior year, and they would pick up offers, you know, September, October, November, December, January, and sign in a big school in February. That has changed a ton with the early signing day, and it's pushed up the evaluation process for a lot of these kids. So sophomore and junior film, the pressure on the kids to perform as sophomores and juniors is greater than it's ever been, which, you know, a lot of times if you play 6A football, 5A football, a kid who's a sophomore, even if he's a really good player, is a limited player in your program when he's playing as a sophomore, if you have a really take into consideration with that stuff. I think another thing, you know, the whole NIL thing, you know, I think players should be able to make money on their name, image, and likeness. I think the idea behind NIL is okay. I think if a student who's in a math class at the University of Georgia can go sell t-shirts and make money on it, then I think the starting quarterback at Georgia should be able to sell T-shirts with his face on and make money on it too. I don't believe the NCAA did a very good job with the rollout of NIL. I think they probably could have done a much better job of marketing. I think what it was intended to do and be has been corrupted. And I think that's why you kind of see that kind of the way it is right now with college sports. I think there is some of that bleeds into a little bit with the higher end players in the high school level who are getting paid. As a high school kid, they're getting paid to visit college campuses. I mean, you know, $5,000 to $10,000. If you want a 5-star kid to come on your campus, my understanding it's $5,000 to $10,000 to get them on campus. Wow. And so, to me, I don't agree with that. I don't believe that is the way it should go. You know, the transfer portal, a lot of people are down on that one. But, you know, I mean, heck, the kids ought to be able to go to a different school if they want to go. I mean, I don't necessarily like it. I think it's harder for colleges. But the other side is, I mean, hell, it's America. You want to go, you should get to go whatever school you want to go to.
That's right.
And now I think the transfer portal has negatively impacted high school recruiting because so many colleges focus on the portal so much that you're not getting as many kids offered out of high school. And I think it's going to become top heavy at some point in time. They can't sign enough kids to support college football. The other side is I would say most of the people coming out of the portal and from talking with a lot of college coaches are backing off on signing a bunch of portal kids because in a lot of ways what you're doing is getting other people's problems. You know, I think if you talk to college coaches, that's what a lot of them are saying. They're looking around going, you know what, we're not signing as many portal kids because most of those guys didn't have an impact for us or they were problems when we got them in the locker room. We'd rather just recruit some kids and develop our guys over the next 3 or 4 years, you know. So it's an issue, you know, and that recruiting has changed tremendously at the high school level in the last 5 or 6 years.
Yeah, I can see that. That's been – such a hot topic with everything that's gone on. And, you know, I think a student should play wherever they want to play when they get to that college level. And so, but it seems like it's much harder for the college coaches now because they kind of have to re-recruit the players they have.
They do. But so the college coaches have dug this hole for themselves.
They have.
And because what they've done is, you know, the transfers at the high school level, kids who just transfer wherever they want to go, college coaches have just gone in and recruited those kids, and they don't care if they played at 3 or 4 high schools. We don't care. He's a good player, so we're just going to recruit him. Well, now those kids want to transfer 3 or 4 times at the high school level. So, you know, they've made their bed. Let them lay in it. And when they come in and complain about how they have to work 20 hours a day and recruit every kid, I look at them and go, well, that's your fault because you're signing those type of kids. Sign kids that are loyal to their high school team, that show up on campus the first day and spend 4 years there, sign the right type of kids, you know? And I think, you know, I think if you look at a guy like Kirby Smart, and sure, I'm sure he's getting some guys that transfer here or there. I think that guy runs – the reason that they've got the best players, but the other thing they have is I think he's got the best culture.
Mm-hmm.
He's got the best culture. You don't see him losing 30 guys to the transfer portal every year. He's not signing 30 in the transfer portal every year because he's signing guys – who have a specific mindset and those guys want to come in, they want to bust their hump, they want to turn themselves in, and he sells them on it. And he does a great job of that. And I think that's, if you look at that, and then you have the other side of that is Dabo Swinney, who doesn't want to dabble in the portal at all and wants to develop kids over the course of 3 or 4 years and probably would be able to do that, except he's losing so many guys to the transfer portal. So I think they're trying to figure out who are the 25 guys to sign at Clemson who are going to stay committed in the program and be able to wait to develop over 3 or 4 years. I really root for him because I hope that works. I hope that works out for him because that's the program that I run. I don't recruit any kids. We're going to take a bunch of kids. The kids that show up here as ninth graders, we're going to train their butts off for 4 years, and we're going to turn them into football players. We're going to have a good football team with the kids that show up in this building. I'm not in the business of going to recruit kids. And I don't want a bunch of transfers. That's not what I want. I want to develop a relationship with kids, change their lives, and go bust their humps and turn them into men.
That's great. Thank you for bringing up Dabo Swinney, because I was going to ask about that, because his philosophy is very different. He's really kind of swimming upstream with all that. But one of the things is, like, the freshman, you know, when I was in high school, you were a freshman. You had nothing to do with JV or you know, the varsity team. Is that the same way it works now? Do you have a freshman that maybe could actually step up and play on a Friday night?
You know, we've had a few. And so usually if a freshman plays for us, it's probably because we have a hole somewhere in the lineup. We're thin on the offensive line, or we're thin at wide receiver, and we have a talented kid in the freshman class. So we've played two or three guys, and that's usually been the case when we played them, is because we were just kind of shy of some guys at a position here or there. And we had this guy who was really good, and he was able to play. Usually, if you're playing freshman, you're probably not going to have a great football team. Now, that's at 5A, 6A level in the state of Georgia. At single A football, you're going to play a bunch of freshmen, because you're going to have 30, 40 kids in the program. There are schools in the state, and you got 40 boys on the football team, you're going to play ninth graders. And so the game is very different. I've never coached at a small school. I tell some friends who coach single A football, if somebody walked in and said, "Hey, you're the new head coach at McIntosh County," I wouldn't know how to run a practice. I have never run a practice with 40 kids before like that. So for me, it would be so different. I would have to go and sit down and talk with people. "Hey, man, how do you structure practices and look at practice schedules?" And it would be a learning process for me to do that with so few kids, because I'm used to running programs with 110, 130, 140, 150 kids in it. Play 11-11. There are some 8-man football teams out there. I think there's a few in Georgia. But they still play. But even Frederica here, you know, I don't know how big the school is, a couple hundred kids there. But, you know, he's got 25 kids on the football team. They play 11-man football with Giesa. But, you know, look, and he's playing some ninth grader kids. But that's what you have to do at that level. But everybody is generally doing that when you're playing that level of football. And so – Bradley Warren at McIntosh does a great job. He does. He's a really good football coach. Does a great job of what he does, and it's going to be very different than my job here. It's two different animals, and it would be a learning process for me to go and do it.
Yeah, that'd be. I know a few people that played that 8-on-8, and I always just found that, oh my god, I couldn't do that. It'd be really tough.
I've seen some videos of it. I don't know enough about it. But, you know, it's like anything else. It's guys or, you know, kids that want to play football. They're getting a chance to go do it. And, you know, more power to them. I know out in kind of in the Midwest and kind of Kansas, Oklahoma, there's a lot of 8-man football out there, because you've got these small schools in these communities, rural communities. Mm-hmm. So, you know, more power to them. Go get after it.
Now, you have a 130 on the football program, but you play 11 on the field, mm-hmm. correct? Like, how do you choose your roster?
The freshmen play freshman ball, so we still have freshman team. The sophomores are JV. And so basically all of our kids, 10th, 11th, 12th, dress out Friday night with us.
Okay.
They all dress out Friday night with us. Our sophomores and any junior that does not start plays in the JV game. I want kids who are playing, not sitting the bench for a whole year. So right. My juniors who do not start for us on Friday nights are going to play in the JV games on Thursdays. And then outside of that, the course of a game on a Friday night, we probably play 40 kids. And so we find time for kids to contribute to the football program. So, again, don't ask me what our kids can't do. Tell me what they can do, and let's find things they can do. So we find some ways to look at kids and go, this guy is a kid that he's really good in the run game. So on first downs, he might be in on run game, and then he comes out. This guy's really – he's a good cover guy. So we're going to put him in there during coverage situations. And so it's about using our personnel, just using what we have. Getting kids off the field on extra point, field goal, kickoff, kick return. Where can we find some guys to go out there and we'll put their face on somebody and block somebody on a kick return? Run down the field and cover a kick. all those things are, you know, it's looking at guys who this guy will run and tackle. Okay, he can be on the kickoff team. It's finding ways to utilize the talent that I have been given.
Right.
And it's just like anything else, whether you're a federal law enforcement officer or you work in a business, utilizing the things at your disposal.
Right. Awesome.
One of the things, you know, with football is there's with skill positions, there's a lot of technique and a lot of things that you do on the field. There's technique in throwing the football, technique in running your routes, technique in tackling. And, you know, when you watch some of the college and a lot of the pros, it drives me nuts because they're putting their heads down. They're just kind of leading in with their shoulder. And I will always remember my high school football coach, Doug Arangio, and he's like, you got to see what you hit.
Yep.
You have your head up, you know, face mask in the numbers, arms around the legs, and you drive them down to the ground.
Yep.
Why do these kids – because I know you train that. I know you teach that. Why do they get away from that as they move up in the ranks?
Well, I don't necessarily think they do. I think you just have – I mean, there's some – like, you have undisciplined kids at every level. I mean, there's probably some of that. And some guys who aren't good tacklers aren't going to be, you know, the NFL, not for long. Mm-hmm. They're not going to be there for long if they can't tackle, if they can't learn to tackle. And sometimes, you know – so there's a lot of things that go into it. Tackling has really changed in the last 15 or 20 years. Because of the concussion issue. Mm-hmm. So most people are using a different type of tag. It used to be you go put your face on somebody, and that's what they say. We still say, hey, you got to see what you hit. But now most people are doing rugby-style tacklings or what they call the Seahawk. The Seahawks developed what they call the hawk tackling. We call it terror tackling version of tackling. There are guys who specialize in teaching tackling who go all over the country and work with NFL teams and college teams. One of them, the best ones, is in Georgia. The Tackling Academy, a guy by the name of Spencer Smith does it. He's got great videos, and he's got great tackling videos to go online and learn how to teach young people how to tackle. But I think, you know, it's like tackling's a skill like anything else. And, you know, something you said, the skill players, the real skill players are the guys on the line of scrimmage. Mm-hmm. The most skilled players in a football game are the offensive linemen. And it's in the defensive linemen. Those are the places where fundamentals, technique matters more than anything. And technique matters on a football field all over the place. But on the lines of scrimmage, so much goes into being good and winning there. Just everything. Just from the, I do clinics, and I'll do 50 minutes on literally steps, just on foot placement. Mm-hmm. Foot placement. And most people don't spend enough time and think about that. But if you think about it, if I take a big step. You know, I take a big step, I'm off balance. I can't, and then if I overextend it, I can't drive with my back foot and put any power in it. The goal for us is to get 2 feet in the ground as quickly as possible so we can knock the hell out of somebody on the lines of scrimmage. And so having the discipline that we're going to put 2 quick steps and boom, boom, and that's you know, the most.
It's the most thankless job, too.
It is. You don't get your name in the paper over there.
No, but, they're some of the most important pieces to the game. If people kind of forget to or look over that, say, look at the quarterback and the receivers and the running back, I'll tell you, as a former running back, I appreciate a good offensive line. And how do you get these guys? Because it's tough for them. It's just, you know, a car wreck every single play for them. They're going – at someone right across, yes, technique is the biggest part because you have, especially on offense, your hands have to be a certain way. You know, if you get one hand a little bit loose, it's a
pad level. Pad level hands, footwork, hips. I mean, you literally, everything in your body's got to be in conjunction to be successful.
Okay, so we're getting close to the end here, and I want to thank you for your time because we've really been going on for a while. We lost track of time. But you're just at the start of your season. You got Yeah. How many more games left do you have?
We have 7 games left. Yeah.
So 7 more games left. And I wish you the best of luck. Hope you win all 7 of them.
Me too.
We can't wait to get out there. We do love coming here, watching some of your games during the season.
Awesome.
They're great games to watch. I'm a huge football fan. So yeah. High school, college, pros. I can't support my Patriots right now. So, but thank you again for your time here. We really appreciate it, and good luck for the rest of the season.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Go Terriers.